Today, we at Surat branch is having a seminar on blocked input tax credits. We have among us CA Vaibhav Jaju from Ahmedabad. He will be our today's eminent speaker. I welcome Pooja, Madam Chairperson of Vikasa, who will be coordinating along with me for today's session. Welcome, Pooja, ma'am. And with this, I would like to welcome our today's speaker, CA Vaibhav Jaju, who will be deliberating his knowledge among our members. I would now like to request Pooja Madam to introduce our today's speaker, CA Vaibhav Jaju.
Thank you, Johnny Bhai. It is my privilege to introduce our today's eminent speaker, CA Vaibhav Jaju. From Ahmedabad. He possesses Chartered Accountant degree along with it Bachelor of Law, Postgraduate Diploma in Business Finance, Diploma in Export and Import Management, Bachelor of Commerce. Regarding his professional experience, sir is a principal at Drua Advisories, specializing in the field of indirect taxes. He is the indirect tax service practice for Gujarat. He has more than 12 years of experience in litigation, consulting, and advisory practice. During his tenure as a professional, sir has dealt in the areas of service tax, central excise, customs, value-added taxes, central sales tax, foreign trade policies, CESS, and GST. Sir specializes in advising clients across an industry spectrum consisting of manufacturing, telecommunication, real estate, and many more. Sir advises companies on planning, structuring, and optimization on complex indirect tax matters. Sir has assisted to clients for direct indirect tax litigations, including representations before tribunal, appellant authorities, and policy relaxation committee under the FTP. He has been instrumental in the filing writ and revision petitions before the Gujarat High Court. His past stints include E&Y and KPMG. He is a regular contributor to articles and speaker at seminars organized by the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India and various other trade and professional bodies. He is a faculty of GST certification course conducted by the ICAI. With this note, I welcome CA Vaibhav Jaju sir to take the seminar or webinar on this block input tax credit. Over to you, sir.
Thank you. I thank the Surat branch of WIRC of ICAI for giving this opportunity and inviting me to the committee. Chairman Shri Naveen Ji Jain, Vice Chairman CA Pooja Ji Murarka, Secretary CA Rahul Ji Agrawal, Treasurer CA Arun Ji Narang, and CA Johnny Jain. Thank you for inviting. Now, without taking much time, I will just move to the topic. And as it is said that a picture speaks more than 1,000 words, I would like to start this session with a picture. So this picture depicts the plight. Just a minute. This picture depicts the plight of the erstwhile regime, what used to happen of this NVAT credit. So basically, this used to be the expectation of the industry to get the credit. This was what was permitted by the law. And the vague drafting, conservatively credit availed to avoid litigation. This was the credit availed. Finally, used to come the audit and assessment disallowances. And this was finally availed to the client. So basically, this picture, as I mentioned, would speak 1,000 words. The intent behind introduction of GST was seamless credit. And I'm saying this is not my view. This view is substantiated by a lot of documents of the government that the primary principle of GST is to remove the cascading effect and every rupee discharged as tax should be correspondingly availed as credit. So this is there in the first discussion paper on goods and service tax in India, in the statement of objects and reasons in respect of 122nd Constitutional Amendment Bill 2014, report of the task force on goods and service tax, that is 13th Finance Commission. So basically GST was predominantly introduced to remove the cascading effect to allow seamless flow of credit. And therefore, today's session, I would say, input tax credit is the heart, mind, body, and soul of the GST. And under that session, section 17, subsection 5, we are only deliberating today for around next quarter to 2 hours on this one subsection. And I'm grateful to the organizing committee to understand the nuance that this subsection, which is not even more than 2 pages, we would be discussing for around 2 hours with more than 5 dozen slides. So why? What is the relevance of this section? Basically, this section provides a list of negative inputs and input services. The input tax credit of this is not available. So basically, you are not entitled to the credit of this input and input services, which are listed under section 17, subsection 5, irrespective whether they are used for business or not, whether the supply with where this input and input services are used are taxable or not. So though they are taxable, though they are for business, but you are not allowed to take the credit. And therefore, apart from this, whatever remains, you are eligible to take the entire credit, of course, subject to other terms and conditions prescribed under the section. There are in all half a dozen sections under the input tax credit chapter. And of this half a dozen sections, there are more number of rules in the section. We are only deliberating with this subsection, and this would encompass within it ambit more than 90% of the credit input tax related issues. This one subsection, if you are having command on it, we can reasonably say that 90% of the input tax credit you will be able, you have dealt with the chapter, because rest are not so much having so much nitty gritties. Because today, what predominantly as when we as a consultant or an advisor, or when we are working for our firm or the industry, the predominant question which is expected to answer is whether the credit is eligible or not. And by learning of this section, we would be able to try to find answers to that. So with this, as we have discussed, what is the objectives and relevance of ITC mechanism, I will quickly run you through. GST is a value-added tax wherein taxpayer in transaction chain pays tax on value added by him in the transaction. It is a destination-based consumption tax. Tax on goods or services to be borne by the ultimate customer. Fungibility of the input tax credit. Elimination of minimizing possibilities of levy of tax on tax. And final tax should be on actual value of goods, services, excluding transaction tax, levied in intermediate stage in distribution chain. Business entities in transaction chain are pass-through entities and should not bear the indirect tax incidence. So these objectives can be achieved by 2 ways. No tax at intermediate stage and levy of tax only at last stage of transaction chain. That is at stage when goods are sold to end consumer. And the second approach could be levy of tax on value of goods and services on vendor at each stage of the transaction chain, and provide a set off of tax paid by such vendor on procurement of goods or services for business or profession. So we as a country has chosen the second alternative, keeping in mind the vastness of the country and existence of huge unorganized sector of economy. Seamless flow of credit is a prerequisite of any efficient tax system of taxation. Any blockage of credit defeats basic principle of taxing value addition in the transaction chain. As I mentioned, as per the statement of objects and reasons of the Constitution 122nd Amendment Bill, the purpose of GST subsuming all indirect taxes to avoid cascading effect of taxes. Same purpose is also mentioned in the statement of objects and reasons of CGST Bill. Issues highly debated in the professional circle whether ITC is a constitutional right or a statutory right, whether ITC can be blocked or restricted under GST legislation, because we have seen the objects and the reason which says it should be a seamless credit. Whether section 17 subsection 5 blocking ITC is ultra virus. Now, these are questions. There are no definitive answers. And of course, one can refer the earlier laws or the earlier rulings. Honorable Court have consistently held that ITC is a concession provided by the legislation. So basically, these are some of the rulings under the erstwhile law of the Apex Court, the Supreme Court, which had said that input tax credit or SANVET is a conditional right. And it is a concession given by the statute, which is subject to fulfillment of certain conditions. And in case of Daiichi Kakaria, the Supreme Court said it is an indivisible right. So by looking at these rulings, one can say that it's not a constitutional right, and it's not a, I would say, a right which comes absolute in form. It is with conditions, and there could be restrictions as well. Now, coming to the relevant definitions, which one need to, which would be relevant for today's discussion, that is capital goods. Goods the value of which is capitalized in the books of accounts of the person claiming the credit and which is used or intended to be used in the furtherance or course of business. So there is a departure between the definition of capital goods under the earlier law and the current law. Like under the earlier law, there were specific HSN codes, and only the goods falling under that codes would used to qualify as capital goods. Here, any goods which is capitalized in the books of accounts will qualify as a capital goods. So this is in line with the VAT laws. VAT laws used to have such demarcation or identification for capital goods. Input means any goods other than capital goods used or intended to be used by a supplier in course or furtherance of business. Input service means any service used or intended to be used by a supplier in the course or furtherance of business. Input tax credit means credit of input tax. And what does input tax mean? Input tax in relation to a registered person means central tax, state tax, union tax, integrated tax, charge on any supply of goods or services or both made to him. Tax, but exclude tax paid under composition levy. So input tax doesn't include tax paid under a composition scheme, but includes IGST charge on import of goods, tax paid under reverse charge by the recipient, and tax payable under reverse charge by registered person on supply made by an unregistered person. Currently, supplies by an unregistered person have not been notified to tax. They were there for a limited period from 1st July to 12th of October 2017. Post that, they had said that if any class of goods or services or suppliers are notified, that will only be qualifying under payment for tax by the recipient for if the supplier is unregistered. Currently, there is no notification prescribing any class. Relevant definition and provision, section 16(1), which allows the credit. Every registered person shall, subject to such conditions and restrictions as may be prescribed, be entitled to take credit of input tax charge on any goods or services or both to him, which are used or intended to be used in the course or furtherance of his business, and the said amount shall be credited to the electronic ledger of such person. So only registered person is entitled to ITC. Scope of inputs, input services and capital goods has been widened as compared to SANVET credit rules. Under CCR, credits available only when inputs or input services were used in manufacturing of final products or for providing output service. Now it is for use of business or intended use for the business. Both are covered. So litigation around demonstrating nexus between input service and output service would end. Entitlement based on usage in course or furtherance of business. Here, I would refer to the a ruling for the SANVET credit regime of the Bombay High Court in case of Coca-Cola India Private Limited, where the concept in course or furtherance of business was deliberated at large. And basically, it had put an end to the dispute on eligibility of these listed credits. This is just for your knowledge or the reading purposes, that in the erstwhile regime also, when this term was there, it was deliberated and it was considered to be a wide ambit. Now coming to section 17.5. Section 17.5 of CGST Act read as under: notwithstanding anything contained in subsection 1 of section 16 and subsection 1 of section 18, input tax credit shall not be available in respect of following, namely. Now certain important terms, notwithstanding. So basically section 17 subsection 5 override section 16(1) and section 18 subsection 1. 16(1) we have just seen in the preceding para, which gives you entitlement to credit of input and input services subject to terms and conditions if used for the business or for furtherance of business or intended to be used for the business or furtherance of business. Section 18 subsection 1 provides certain conditions regarding availment of credit under some special circumstances. These are when I have opted for a voluntary registration, when I am opted for a compulsory registration, what happens to my stock of goods or semi-finished goods, inputs and semi-finished goods contained in finished goods, where if today I am into composition scheme and I opt for regular tax, so I am entitled to that credit. And similarly, if today my product is exempted, but tomorrow it becomes taxable. So this section basically overrides these two sections. Shall not ITC on certain goods or services would not be admissible in any case except specified. So under 17.5, whatever has been mentioned, the credit shall not be available unless otherwise specified. So they have given certain exceptions. In those cases, the credit is available. Otherwise, it is not available. Namely, Section 17.5 would be applicable only to the goods or services specifically mentioned therein, because there is namely and then there is a semicolon. Some of the block credit under Section 17.5 have been challenged by the taxpayers at various forums. Taxpayers have sought several advance ruling on block credit. In the ensuing slide, section by clause, we are going to read the law, and thereafter we are going to deliberate on various practical issues, whether the credit should be eligible or not. Here I would just like to put a disclaimer or a word of caution. Though we are in this deliberation process, we are going to refer to number of advance rulings, because these matters have been posted before the advance ruling authority and they have delivered their ruling, and therefore it becomes necessary. But here the intent is not that we believe with the rulings. Here we will clearly come out with our view and give the reasoning why we believe with the ruling, why we don't believe with the ruling, and what are the points or the contentions which the appellant has missed or the authority has not appreciated while giving its order. So starting with the first two sub clauses, section 17.5A and section 17 subsection 5 clause A and clause AA. Now the restriction, these are pertaining to motor vehicle. Section 17.5A puts a restriction on motor vehicle for transportation of persons. Here I would like to highlight that it is only on for transportation of persons. The restriction is not on motor vehicle for transportation of goods. That is first point to be noted. And credit is restricted on what? Which type of motor vehicle? Motor vehicles for transportation of persons having approved sitting capacity of not more than 13 persons, including driver, except when they are used for making following taxable supplies, namely. So basically, any motor vehicle which is with a capacity of 14 or higher is again not covered under this exclusion, and therefore the credit should be available. This is second point. Now, for the vehicles which are with the sitting capacity of 13 or less, the credit is not available. However, if these are used for following taxable supplies, then the credit should be available. What are these supplies? Further supply of such motor vehicle, transportation of passengers, or imparting training on driving such motor vehicles. Next, clause AA, that is for vehicles and aircraft. And credit is restricted on vehicles and aircraft except when they are used for making following taxable supplies, namely such further supply of such vehicles or aircraft, or transportation of passengers, or imparting training on navigating such vehicles or flying such aircraft, transportation of goods. Section 17.5AB, which is pertaining to general insurance, servicing, repair and maintenance. Now it says that these services, the credit, input tax credit shall be available in so far they relate to motor vehicle, vessels or aircraft referred to in the preceding clauses, clause A and clause AA. So what does it typically says is the credit of general insurance, servicing, repair and maintenance shall be available if the credit of your motor vehicle is available. So if it is available, I am using it for the specified services, I am entitled to credit of motor vehicle and also to this. In addition to that, these services shall also be available to a manufacturer of motor vehicle vessels or aircraft, and in supply of general insurance services in respect of such motor vehicle vessels or aircraft insured by him. And rightly so, because under insurance business, it typically happens that if I have insured the vehicle of my customer, to that I may also procure a insurance cover so that my risk is also covered as a company. So that is done by insurance companies. So that is, therefore, they are also eligible. And if you refer, in case of damage or an accident, the insurance company typically pays the bill to the car dealer for the repair maintenance expenses, and therefore they are allowed the credit. Now coming to the nuances, what does the term motor vehicle mean? Under the CGST Act, it mentions that the motor vehicle will have the same meaning as it is assigned to under the Motor Vehicle Act. So now we need to refer to the Motor Vehicle Act for the definition of motor vehicle. Section 2, subsection 28 defines motor vehicle, and it defines the term motor vehicle or vehicle to mean any mechanical propelled vehicle adopted for use upon roads. So there are two conditions. The vehicle should be mechanically propelled, and it should be adopted for use upon roads. So typically a manually propelled vehicle, which would typically a bullock cart or a horse cart, that is not covered under the definition of motor vehicle, and therefore not covered under the restriction as well. Where the power of propulsion is transmitted thereto from an external or internal source and includes a chassis to which a body has not been attached and a trailer, but does not include, what will not be included under motor vehicle is a vehicle running upon fixed rails or a vehicle of a special type adopted for use only in a factory or in other enclosed premises, or a vehicle having less than 4 wheels fitted with engine capacity not exceeding 25 cubic centimeter, basically 25 cc vehicle. So this is what is the definition of motor vehicle. Now conveyance is defined under GST, which includes vessel and aircraft and a vehicle. Here term passenger is also relevant. These all will be relevant for the deliberation of the ensuing slides. The term passenger is again not defined under the GST law. So we will have to refer to the definition, and it is again not defined under the Motor Vehicle Act. And therefore, this term is defined under Maharashtra Motor Vehicle Act. And we define the term passenger to mean any person other than the driver, the conductor, or an employee of the permit holder while on duty in connection with the vehicles carried in a stage carriage on payment of fares. Further, the Black's Law Dictionary, as well as a Supreme Court ruling in case of Sundri versus Union of India, this again passenger has been defined, and it is defined to mean passenger is a person whom a common carrier has contracted to carry from one place to another. Similarly, under the ruling under the Insurance Act in case of New India Assurance, the Kerala High Court has constitute passenger to mean a traveler in or on a public or private conveyance other than driver, pilot, crew, etc. So basically, passenger would typically mean a person who is traveling in the vehicle. That's it. And the traveler could not be the vehicle owner or the staff of the vehicle owner, to put it in very simple terms. Now coming to certain issues, and here I would like that the session shouldn't be monotonous, and maybe the participants, if they wish, they can put their views or comments in the comment box. So the first thing, whether the ITC of motor vehicle purchase or obtained on lease or rent used for transportation of goods is available. Any views? So basically, here I would first refer to the AR, Ishan Resins and Paints Limited, AR by West Bengal Advanced Ruling Authority. Under the West under the West Bengal ruling authority, the authority held that the ITC on trucks or tankers is admissible where these vehicles are leased out, and they clearly observed that under section 17 subsection 5 there is no restriction on goods with on vehicles, motor vehicles which are used for transportation of goods. The restriction is only on motor vehicles used for transportation of passengers, rightly so, and we discussed this under 17.5 as well, and therefore the credit should be available. Now another ruling, whether ITC is available if a company purchases a motor vehicle having approved sitting capacity of 5% for giving it on lease or rent. So again, the capacity of the vehicle is less than 13, so under the block credit, and it is used for transportation of passengers. But if I'm using it for giving it on lease or rent, will the credit be available? So here I will just refer two rulings, again by West Bengal authority Mohana Ghosh. In this case, the appellant used to provide the services of renter cab services, and for which it had procured the motor vehicle. It approached the advance ruling authority to understand whether the ITC could be eligible or not. Sorry, pardon me. There is some voice in the background from the participant side. So it approved the advance ruling authority and said that it is providing transportation of passenger services. Now here are two things to mark off this. The appellant itself said that they are providing transportation of passenger services by providing renter cab service, and therefore it is covered under the ambit and credit should be allowable. The entire discussion of the advance ruling authority was only on that leg of the clause, whether the services of renter cab could be said for supply of transportation of passengers. The authority in its wisdom held that this cannot be termed as passenger of transportation services because the services are different. It is provided for a limited time to the identified person and not in general. With that, they disallowed the credit. Now coming to the second ruling of Nursing Transport by Madhya Pradesh Advance Ruling Authority, where it was held that, referring to the term supply, where one of the conditions for availing credit, that the motor vehicle should be used for further supply. They identified the term supply and referred to section 7, where supply would mean sale, transfer, barter, exchange, lease, rental, or disposal. So basically, leasing and renting is covered under supply, and they allowed the credit. So basically, Mohana Ghosh, we don't agree with the ruling. It's on the wrong acceptance of the law or ignoring certain clauses of the law. Whereas Nursing Transport has rightly said that supply would not be typically limited to sale of goods. Supply is a wider term defined under Section 17. Lease and renting is covered. And therefore, when I use this motor vehicle for leasing and renting, it is further supply of that motor vehicle, which is under the exception to the Section 17.5, and therefore the credit should be eligible. Next question, whether the ITC is available in respect of forklift or material cart used within the factory premises, and whether ITC is available in respect of golf carts purchased by clubs, hotels, and resorts. So first, we should understand what is forklift. Forklift is basically a small vehicle which is used within the factory. It has two horizontal plates, which is typically used for movement of goods or materials from one place to another. That is one thing. And similarly, material cart is something, a small cart under which maybe battery operated, under which the vehicles are loaded and transported. And golf cart, typically you would have seen it. So these are the things, whether it is available now. So two contentions over here. First, they don't qualify under the definition of motor vehicle, because if you refer the definition of motor vehicle under the Motor Vehicle Act, it specifically excludes the vehicle which is designed or used, which are designed for use in a closed premises or a factory. It clearly says. So these are used under factory, and the second golf cart are used under a closed premises. They don't run or commute on the road. That is one part. Second, for the forklift and the, since it is not motor vehicle per se, so the question of coming under 17.5 is as such excluded. So that is the contention. And secondly, whether something qualifies as motor vehicle or not, a layman or general test would be, you could always see a registration plate on the vehicle. Basically, like if on your two-wheelers or four-wheelers, we have a registration plate. Such vehicle doesn't require that because they are not covered under the regulation of Motor Vehicle Act. So you are not required to take a registration. And under both the cases, the credit would be available. Now, coming to a different set of question, this is under the advance authority ruling in case of Indian Cotton Solutions, where the company had used a motor vehicle as a mobile lab and they were testing the quality of cotton. And that was their core business for supply of pesticides and was related to core business. So the question was whether the credit would be eligible or not, since it is used very intrinsically used with the business. The advance authority held that though it is used for the business, but it won't be eligible since it is under the exclusion clause. And under the exclusion clause, for the specified purposes, if it is used, then only the credit is eligible. And rightly so, we agree with the ruling. This is a ruling of Appellate Authority of Advance Ruling of Maharashtra in case of CMS Info Systems Limited. I'm not much great fan of advance rulings, but I would surely or definitely recommend you to read this ruling. It's a very good read and the ruling is very beautifully crafted and drafted. Now, what is the facts of this case? CMS Info System, they are into the provision of services of transportation of currency, cash, from say bank branch to ATMs for their refill and similar type of services. You would have seen typically jeeps or vans being used with grills and gunmen, and they were providing these services. The question was whether the credit is eligible or not. So advance ruling authority denied the credit, saying that currency or money is specifically excluded from the definition of goods under the GST law. So if you refer the goods definition, it clearly says currency or money is not goods. And therefore, what is being used was not for transportation of goods. And therefore, you are not eligible to credit. The matter traveled to Appellate Authority of Advance Ruling. The appellant put the representation and the Appellate Authority rightly in the right spirit considered the representation. And what the argument the Appellate Authority kept was, for them, this cash currency was actually not in the form of cash currency. Reason being, they cannot use this currency or money for the purposes as money or currency. They cannot use it. They cannot buy something from it. For them, it is in the nature of goods. And they are transporting this from one place to another. That is their service. Further, they referred to Section 2 of the CGST Act, the definition clause, which says that under this chapter, unless the context requires otherwise, the definition should be used. So basically, the Act says that the definition has to be used towards the context. Here, applying this analogy, the currency or the money would qualify as goods and would not be under the form or character of money for the service provider, reason being he cannot use it. And this transportation is specialized as per the RBI guidelines and under the security. Considering and appreciating this fact, it should be treated as goods. And once they took a view that it is goods, then the services of the motor vehicle were used for transportation of goods and the credit was allowed. Another question which comes out relating to motor vehicle, whether ITC is available in respect of car used as demo car. Now, typically, what is demo car? If you go to a car dealer for purchasing a car, there is a car which is kept for demo purposes, a sample car under which you can take a test drive. You can sit, you can touch and feel and have the feel of the car to take a decision whether to go for it or not. So here, what the argument the appellant made? The appellant said that first thing, this is for my sales promotion. The car is used as a sales promotion. This car By demonstrating this car, I'm able to sell other cars. So this is used in the course of business. Secondly, they said that after a period of 2-3 years, these cars are generally sold at the written down value. And therefore, it again fulfills the test of further supply of motor vehicle. With this, the authority allowed the credit. So Chaugale Industries had gone for AR at Goa and Maharashtra, and it was allowed. On the similar footing, AM Motors had also allowed the ITC of demo cars, and rightly so. Now, a couple of questions while evaluating. What would does the term approved seating capacity mean? As you said, as we looked under Section 17(5A), it says approved seating capacity of not more than 13%, including driver. Now, what would approved seating capacity would mean? So typically, what if, and this is a practical query which was dealt with, if there is a car, a traveler, which is having a capacity of 14, which is basically not restricted. But today, if I modify that traveler and make it into a 6-seater spacious vehicle, a luxury vehicle, will the credit be admissible or it will deny? So in my view, the credit should be eligible. Approved seating capacity has to be seen from the point what is approved under a Motor Vehicle Act. If Motor Vehicle Act has certified a vehicle to be used or adapted to be used for a sitting capacity of 13 and above and of 14 and above, and if I'm adopting it and modifying it and making it for a lesser capacity, that won't take away my right. So in my view, the credit should be available. Whether disposal as scrap can be regarded as further supply of such motor vehicles. So today, the whole controversy would end if I take a stand that ultimately I'm going to sell it. Like in demo car, I'm going to sell it with a WDV after 2-3 years. What happens if I sell a car after as a scrap? Will the credit be eligible? Now, 2 points of contention over here. First, when you sell something as a scrap, that means it is not in form and shape of a motor vehicle. It cannot be used as a motor vehicle. That is one point. Second point, if you refer to the Motor Vehicle Act, when you are supposed to sell a car as a scrap, you need to go for a cancellation of a registration of the motor vehicle. And once you cancel that as under the Motor Vehicle Act, it is not a motor vehicle. And therefore, the credit won't be available. This argument won't sustain. Now, second question, some more questions. Whether ITC is available in respect of bus or car purchased for pickup or drop off workers, or whether ITC is available in respect of hire charges paid for contract buses and car deployed for pickup and drop facilities of employees. So basically, we are saying either I purchase a car or a bus, or I get a lease or on rental basis a car or a bus for the transportation of my employees, what will be the stance of the credit? Here, ruling of YKK India by Appellate Authority of Advance Ruling, it clearly said that ITC on hiring of buses for transportation of employees shall be admissible, as hiring and renting are synonymous. And on car, it shall not be available because it is less than the sitting capacity. So rightly so. So basically, bus are typically beyond 14 or above seats, and therefore whether purchased or availed on lease, the credit shall be available. For cars, since they are 13 or less in numbers, sitting capacity, the credit wouldn't be available. Only under the entire this gamut, one question which is something which has to be tested before the judiciary and needs to be explored. Can I, as a client to my client or as a industry, take a view that employees are passengers? If I take a view, then I can say that it is under the exception to Section 17(5) where the car is used for transportation of passenger, and therefore the credit should be available. In the preceding slides, we have seen the definition of passengers. Passenger would typically mean anyone other than the owner of the vessel or the employee or staff member to the vehicle. And therefore, this view needs to be explored and needs to be seen whether credit can be availed. Whether ITC is available in respect of passenger vehicle used for transportation of goods. Now here two practical scenarios I will give. If you look out typically an electricity company, say in Surat you have Torrent, in Ahmedabad we have Torrent. So what typically happens is they have a Jeep or a van sort of a vehicle in which typically the technician or the service engineer is there along with a lot of material, their insulators, repair material, fuses, ladders, all that. And that is being used to cater to the fault or the electricity disruption complaints. Immediately, this mobile vans come and they do their repair and maintenance and go. So under such scenario, this is first scenario to my question, whether the credit will be available or not. Here in my view, typically I would say that the vehicle is used for transportation of goods because and the person over there is to cater the service. And therefore it is used for transportation of goods. And applying the dominant intent test, I should get the credit, BSNL ruling on dominant intention. Now a different variant to this question, this was first variant, different variant to this question, where a passenger vehicle is used for transportation of goods. If you typically see a eco or a van, that is a passenger vehicle. It is registered under Motor Vehicle Act as a passenger vehicle. I purchase that vehicle, I modify it in the sense I cover the glasses with a metal sheet, I enclose the windows, and I use the vehicle for transportation of goods only. Now, whether the credit should be eligible because it is less than 13-seater, a passenger vehicle. Here again, applying the dominant intention test, if I'm able to substantiate and prove that I'm using this vehicle only for the purposes of transportation of goods, irrespective of the nature of the vehicle, it being a transportation vehicle, a passenger vehicle, I should be eligible to the credit. Now a different set of question, whether ITC is available in respect of vehicles used for transportation of goods as well as for transportation of employees. Now, what we are trying to say over here is, we have seen a couple of times in the past discussion right away that the restriction is on goods which are used for transportation of persons. The restriction is not on goods which are on vehicles which are used for transportation of goods. Now, this is a single vehicle, say a Maruti Eco van. I'm using it for transportation of goods without any modification asset, as well as for my transportation of employees also, for both purposes. Now what happens? What should be my credit or happen to my credit? In my humble opinion, I will take the credit. And the reason there is, and the specific reason there is, that Section 17.5 does not restrict credit for transportation of goods. Further, Section 17.5 or any other rule does not provide me with any mechanism where an input or input service is used for two purposes. One is allowed, that is not covered under 17.5, like transportation of goods, and the other is restricted under 17.5, that is transportation of passengers. So in absence of any mechanism, I can say that the credit should be available by applying the Supreme Court ruling of income tax in case of B.C. Srinivasa Setty, which was followed under the indirect tax law, service tax law of Delhi High Court in case of Suresh Kumar Bansal. So just to give more clarity, like when I use any input and input services which are used for supply of taxable goods as well as exempted goods, then I take the proportionate credit because there is a mechanism given under Rule 42. But under 17.5, there is no such rule or no such mechanism provided which gives such option. So in absence of mechanism, I will take the advantage. Section 17.5B. So credit is restricted on specified supply of goods or services, that is foods and beverage, outdoor catering, beauty treatment, health services, cosmetic and plastic surgery, life insurance and health insurance, leasing, renting, or hiring of motor vehicle, vessels or aircraft referred into clause A or clause AA except when used for specified purposes. Further, the credit of this category, this top five bullets, will be available except where said category of inward supply of goods or services or both are used for making an outward supply of same category of goods or service or both as part of taxable composite or mixed supply. So meaning thereby, if I am into a business of beauty treatment and I have availed beauty treatment services as input to provide beauty treatment services as output, I shall be eligible to credit. That is what it is saying. And for the other two bullets, membership of a health club and fitness center, travel benefits extended to employees on vacation such as leave or home travel concession. And all the seven bullets, all the above said, shall be available as credit if it is obligatory for an employer to provide it to its employees under any law. Now with this, let us go to the nuances. Now, what is the meaning of the phrase obligatory for an employer to provide to its employee under any law used in section 17.5b? Whether it covers facility given to employees under terms of contract? So basically what I'm trying to explore over here is, if suppose I have a contract with my employee that I shall provide you food and beverages, that I shall provide you pickup and drop facilities. These are restricted under 17.5, but because there is a contract and that contractually it is enforceable under Indian Contract Act, and therefore I as an employer is obligated to honor to the terms of the contract, will I be eligible to become the credit under 17.5? So what would be the term obligatory for employer to provide would mean? So in my view, this is not the intention of the law. This had come with a subsequent amendment with effect from February 2019 after representations being made to the council. And this is clearly not the intention. It would typically mean when something is obligated or mandated under the local laws or any law for the time being in force. So just to give you an example, in cities like Bangalore, Bombay, Delhi, metro cities, where you have typically IT industry, your KPO or BPO industry, and the working hours or the shift hours are odd hours in the night, late night hours. And for the security of the employees and the personnel, the local laws of that state have mandated that the employee has to provide a pickup and drop facility. And that would then mean that it is obligated under law to the employer and the credit would be eligible. In such scenario, if I take a motor vehicle which is less than 13 or up to 13% person capacity and I use it for pickup and drop of my employees, the credit will be eligible as it is obligated to the employer under a law. So this was the point. Now coming to certain ERs, ordnance factory, this is appellate authority of advance ruling, hospital and medical facilities. So it was mandatory for under the legislation for them, under the law, to have a hospital and medical facilities within the campus of their factory. And since it was mandatory, the credit was eligible. NIPA exports, they had procured ambulance. Again, it was under a law mandating them to have an ambulance in the factory premises, but the credit was denied. The reason being, this was for the pre-amended period. The amendment getting this clause of obligatory for an employee was inserted in February 2019, while NIPA Export had purchased the ambulance in November 2018. And generally, there is a law which is being put by the earlier rulings that credit has to be seen at the time when the goods or inputs or capital goods are availed or received. Another deliberations, whether ITC is available in respect of accidental insurance for their staff personnel. Any views participants would like to share on this? Okay, basically if you refer, the exclusion under 17.5 is towards health and life insurance. accidental insurance are not excluded. So once they are outside the ambit of Section 17(5), you are eligible to take the credit. Whether ITC is available on reimbursement of lunch, dinner or snack expenses, restaurant to employees, especially marketing team or field staff. So basically restriction is there under food and beverages, and therefore the credit shouldn't be eligible unless it is obligatory. Now here one thing, someone may try to explore that the words are food and beverages. What if I only provide food without beverage or beverage without food, and therefore since the words are and I am not fulfilling, I am not providing that simultaneously, will I be eligible to credit? In my view, literal interpretation, yeah, this can be there. But in my view, this is not the intention of the law. And here I would like to refer a ruling of Bill Forge under the earlier Sandwich Credit Rule, Rule 14, where the dispute was availment or utilization for levy of interest. And the court has held that the word or there has to be interpreted as and. And here also, giving the persuasive interpretation, it would end the intention. The word and should be construed as or, and therefore, even if food or beverage is being given, it should not be eligible. This is an interesting query, a real life query which we came across from a film producer. If a film producer procures services of dietitians for monitoring diet of his actor or actress, whether he can claim ITC on such expenditure, and whether services of dietitian fall under health services as mentioned under Section 17(5). So health services are excluded under 17(5B). So what happened? Now here, the term health services is nowhere defined under the Act. What is defined under the Act is under an exemption notification, that is health care services. So the word care is there, C-A-R-E, care. So health services cannot be equated with health care services. So there is no meaning. Now, typically, I would take you to practical examples being Bollywood fan. If you would have watched the movie Dangal, where Aamir Khan was required to put a lot of weight within some limited period of time. And what do you feel? The weight would have been typically gained by having junk food, high cal diet, cold drinks, chocolates, and by no means or stretch of imagination, these are for health. These are not for your good health. A completely diverse example, if you would have watched the movie Sarabjit, Randeep Hooda, the actor, had to lose tremendous weight within a short period of time, and he had to literally starve. And he was weighed below 50 or 45 kgs for that movie. Now starving is again not in interest of the health. But these both the things are done under the guidance or the advice of the dietitian to ensure that the weight is quickly gained or the weight is quickly reduced, and with ensuring that nothing much adverse happened. So here the submission is, these are not health services, as I mentioned. These are not for health purposes, not health services. And therefore it would not qualify under health service. And therefore, the credit should be available. Similarly, a different example. What about the ITC on makeup services, which you typically have under film, under film industry, under airline, under hospitality industry? Whether the, and this is a cost, this involves cost, whether the ITC would be available or not. Because beauty treatment is outside the scope of credit. It is under 17(5B). So again, being a Bollywood fan, I will take you to the example. If you have seen the movie Pa of Amitabh Bachchan, where he was makeup, and believe me, he was not handsome, or he cannot be said that it would add an element of beauty. He was barely adorable. And therefore, there was absence of beauty element. So since beauty treatment, we say the first element of beauty per se is not there, Can you say that it is under the ambit of duty treatment? No, because there is no duty. That is one argument. But then what happens to the airline or hospitality industry? So there the argument would typically be that treatment, the word treatment, if you see, it encompasses in itself a certain degree of permanency. There has to be a certain degree of permanency, anticipation of that. Makeup is for sure not permanent. It's in itself temporary. And therefore, the word beauty, treatment, when it encompasses permanency, in absence of that, it is again outside the ambit of restriction. And therefore, the credit should be available. Coming to clauses C and D, works contract services, clause C, when supplied for construction of an immovable property, other than plant and machinery, except where it is an input service for further supply of works contract service. Goods or services or both, when it is received by a taxable person for construction of an immovable property other than plant and machinery on his own account, including when used in course or furtherance of business. So these are the restrictions. Now, what does works contract mean? It means building, construction, fabrication, completion, erection, installation, fitting out, improvement, modification, repair, maintenance, renovation, alteration, or commissioning of any immovable property, wherein transfer of property in goods, whether as goods or in some other form, is involved in the execution of such contract. And what does the term construction mean? Construction includes reconstruction, renovation, addition, alteration, repairs to the extent of capitalization to the said immovable property. Plant and machinery means apparatus, equipment, machinery, fixed work by foundation or structural support that are used for making outward supply and includes such foundation and structural support, but excludes land, building, or any other civil structure, telecommunication towers, and pipeline laid outside the factory premises. So basically, the first question, section 17.5D restricts ITC where goods or services are received by a taxable person for construction of an immovable property other than plant and machinery on his own account. What does the phrase on own account would mean? Now, I would refer to the judgment of Safari Retreats, much deliberated, circulated, discussed between the professional fraternity and the industry of the Honorable Orissa High Court. The facts of the case were, here the company had constructed a mall, and the mall, the spaces under the mall were not to be sold, but to be leased out perpetually. So they would never sell it, they will always lease the space. And they went to the High Court filing a writ for the ITC. What did the High Court observe? The moot observations of the High Court. Narrow construction of interpretation of section 17.5D is frustrating the very objective of the act. So basically it had gone to the objects which we discussed in the beginning of the presentation, that the various documents by the government and the commissions have said that it should have the seamless flow of credit. If the SSC would have disposed of the property before receipt of completion certificate, he would be liable to pay GST and be entitled to claim credit of input tax charge on supply of goods or services. So typically they are referring to construction services, where for construction services before BU or OC, if you sell the property, then you have to discharge GST and you are eligible to credit. Here, company is retaining the property and is not using for its own purpose. It is letting out the same on which it is discharging GST liability. Provisions of section 17.5D is to be read down and narrow restriction as imposed by the department is not required to be accepted, keeping in mind the very purpose of credit is to give benefit to SSC. If the SSC is required to pay GST on rental income arising out of the investment on which he has paid GST, it is required to have the input tax credit of GST, which he is required to pay under section 17.5D of the CGST Act. However, Honorable High Court did not hold section 17.5D to be ultra vires. That is not held. The SLP is filed before Supreme Court. The matter is pending. However, the order of the High Court is not stayed, so it is still operational. Now, with this background, what did the court do? The bench was humble enough they had 2 points into consideration. They took 2 points into consideration. First thing, what they held was, they did a comparative analysis. They said that if the property was outright sold before BO, appellant would have been eligible to credit. Simply, it is not sold. It is leased out and he is paying GST there also. The credit is not eligible. That was first contention. Second thing which the High Court considered was, they applied the usage test for the term on own account rather than the interpretation or the constructive interpretation to the words or the literal interpretation. To them, on his own account, they put a usage test saying that they are not using it, rather they are renting it out. They are not using it. In my view, this I don't ascribe to this ruling, because the word own account has to be seen literally and interpreted literally. Own account would mean when I don't partake the property and keep it to myself. If I am selling it, then it is not on own account. If I am keeping it, though for rendering services, it is on my own account only. So I don't agree with the view, and this will have to be revisited basis the final outcome of the Supreme Court. And I personally believe that Supreme Court shall overturn this ruling. Keeping the background of Safari Retreats Orissa High Court ruling in mind, certain questions which are in the lines of Safari Retreat, whether one can claim ITC on goods or services procured for construction of shopping mall, where shops are to be given on rent, shops are to be sold before receipt of completion certificate, some shops are to be sold and balance to be given out. Certain rulings, Tarun Realtors, it is appellate authority of advance ruling. The appellant is developing a shopping mall which includes a hypermarket, multiplex cinema, theater, etc. For development, it is required to procure various goods and services including works contract services. It was held that the appellant is not eligible for ITC on such procurement as they form part and parcel of the building and civil structure and not plant and machinery. So they said it's an immovable property and therefore shouldn't be available. Ashish Arvind Hansoti, the appellant is not eligible to claim ITC of GST paid on input and input services used for construction of commercial immovable property subsequently used for leasing out. Sri Vara Lakshmi Mahal LLP, they basically constructed a marriage hall and were leasing and renting out and wanted to avail the ITC. Again, it was here the authority held that this is on own account, even though used for business, should not be eligible. Now, with this background, if we refer to the answers, shops given on rent, ITC shouldn't be eligible. Sold before receipt of completion certificate, ITC should be eligible. Shops which are given on rent under the same mall and certain shops which are sold. So for the shops which are sold before completion certificate, the proportionate input-input services should be eligible, and for the balance should not be eligible. Now, what will be the ITC implication in respect of pipeline partially laid out in factory premises and partially laid out outside factory premises? Definition of plant and machinery excludes pipeline laid outside the factory premises. What will be the treatment in following cases? If pipeline is partially within factory and partially outside factory, and will it make a difference if pipeline is movable? So coming to first the rulings, then we will come to the conclusions. Western Concessions Private Limited, Appellate Authority of Advance Ruling. Again, a very good ruling. I am not on the conclusion, but the way the appellate authority has dealt with the ruling, it's a good ruling to read about. Here, what is the fact that there is a LNG and it requires a regasification. So there is LNG which is stored on the landmass on land, and certain kilometers away through pipeline, there is a floating structure on water where there is regasification unit and the gas is regasified, and post regasification from this floating structure, it is transmitted to the grid, and from the grid, that is the network of pipeline, it goes to the respective customer. Now the appellant here had approached for the credit beyond that floating structure where the regasification activity is done till the grid, the 60 kilometer pipeline, whether the credit is eligible or not. Here, the authority relied on the Supreme Court ruling of MSCO Private Limited and held that where the term is not defined under the Act, here the factory was not defined under the Act, the definition, it's not good to take a definition from some different act or a legislation. The word has to be interpreted in its common parlance and how contextually a person would refer considering the law. So they said you don't have to refer to the definition of for factory premises to identify whether that floating structure is factory premises. Don't refer to the definition under other acts. And basis the common parlance test, they said that this floating unit has walls, it has shades, and under this floating unit, the activity of regasification is done. And therefore, this floating unit, which is not on land, nevertheless, it doesn't matter, it is on water, but it constitutes a factory premises. And therefore, the pipeline beyond factory premises wouldn't be eligible to the credit. So now coming to the with this conclusions. So clearly, since they are not eligible, so anything which is outside factory premises should not be available. If there is a pipeline which is within as well as outside, I would be eligible to the proportionate credit of input and input services used for the pipeline within the factory premises. And what happens if pipeline is movable property? Whether it is movable or immovable will not make much of a difference in my view, because it is specifically excluded and therefore that has to be given consideration and wouldn't be eligible to credit. What would be the ITC implications where items such as electrical pumps, electrical works, pumping system, tanks, lighting system, physical security system, and fire system are debited to plant and machinery account and not to building account? Now, why this question? Definition of the term construction is based on accounting treatment given by the taxpayer. What would be the consequence if accounting treatment is not in consonance with accounting standard? Capital expenditure written off as revenue expenditure and revenue expenditure capitalized to immovable property. So basically, if you refer the definition of construction, it says construction includes repair, renovation, finishing, blah, blah, blah. And it says to the extent capitalized to immovable property. And therefore, the question over here is, if I do certain activities or procure certain input and input services, and it tantamounts to immovable thing, and I account it as a movable thing, then basis mere accounting, am I eligible to credit? There's a ruling of Embassy Industrial Park. In this ruling, the appellant used to create warehouses and rent space under this commercial warehouse. And what the appellant had typically a contention which he had done was the same thing where certain immovable things were being accounted as movable. The advance authority held that merely accounting of an immovable property as movable property in the books of accounts of the applicant does not divest the exact nature of the item. And when what is procured is an immovable property, it remains an immovable property, no matter how the same is accounted. So basically, your accounting treatment should be in consonance with the generally accounting practices and should not get colored with the eligibility of ITC. That is what the point is. And I also subscribe to the same point that if it has to be accounted as movable, then it will be eligible. If something which is immovable accounted as movable, the accounting treatment will not fetch me ITC. Whether ITC is available in respect of following items: sewage treatment plant, firefighting system, cable for transmission of electricity from feeding point to the building, other materials such as PCC posts, structural steel, cable end kit, HDPE pipes, go switch, etc., laying and cable and electric installation for installation of electricity, shed and foundation in relation to plant and machinery. Apart from shade and foundation, for rest of the things, we will refer to the ruling of Synergy Global Steel Limited, again, authority of advance ruling. So in this case, the sewage treatment plant, the treatment plant was treated separately and the appellant argued it's a plant and machinery. The authority held that sewage treatment plant is part and parcel of, is a civil structure, and it is part and parcel of building and therefore immovable, and therefore ITC should not be available. Similarly, on the same footing, installation of firefighting system, cable transmission system, all this, ultimately they form part and parcel of your building only, and therefore the credit is not eligible. I cannot treat that under the building. I am treating this as separate, though they are attached to the building and fastened to the building, because ultimately it becomes part and parcel of the building and credit should not be available. Now coming to this, sheds and foundation in relation to plant and machinery. And before going to this, I would just once again refer to the definition of plant and machinery. It says apparatus, equipment, machinery, fixed to earth by foundation or structure support that are used for making output supply, and includes such foundation and structural support, but excludes land, building or any other civil structure, telecommunication towers and pipeline laid outside the factory premises. Now with this, this ruling where they had approached the authority, where the foundation to machinery and shed over the machinery was treated as structural support. However, the advance ruling authority held that what is being excluded is other civil structure from the plant and machinery, and therefore it should not be available. In my humble view, if you recall, there are two parts to the definition. The includes part says that foundation and the structural support will be included as plant and machinery. And then there is exclusion to civil structure. So keeping a logical, a harmonious interpretation, if there is foundation and a foundation to machinery will typically be of a civil structure. And I would refer to the rulings of erstwhile rule Sidhpur paper mills, where you require a foundation for wobble free operation of the machine so that the machine doesn't vibrate. And since the definition says that it becomes part and parcel, and it is, the foundation itself is like plant and machinery, it should be eligible, and then it excludes civil structure. So if one refers this harmoniously, since it is once included, the subsequent exclusion cannot take the benefit, since it has partaken the character of plant and machinery and the credit should be eligible. Section 17.5 C and D restricts ITC where goods or services are procured are to be used for construction of immovable property. What does the term immovable property mean? Whether falling will be movable or immovable? Now there are a lot of judgments in the past, Brill Mumbai Corporation and such others, Solid Engineering and Works, which have deliberated what constitutes movable and what constitutes immovable. They will have bearing in the GST regime also. Now certain things. Glass and furniture partition used in offices or co-spaces, whether credit will be eligible. Telecommunication towers, telecommunication infrastructure. Let's take it one by one. Glass and furniture partitions. So there is this ruling of WeWork India Management, where it was held as glass partitions are not permanent and can be dismantled without demolishing the civil structure and moved according to the requirement of the client of the appellant. Further, what the client has done, it had capitalized it under its financials under the head furnitures and fixtures. It is not part of building. And rightly so, this partitions and glass slidings can be removed. And they are therefore in the form of movable property. And the credit was allowed, and rightly so. Coming to the second point, telecommunication towers, will the credit be eligible if it is movable? The answer is no, they are under the specific exclusions. What about telecommunication infrastructure? Now there is this advance ruling of Vidya Telelinks, where they have clearly distinguished before the authority what is telecommunication infrastructure and what is telecommunication tower. And what they were contemplating was toward telecommunication infrastructure, and on which there were no antennas, it was only for stringing the cables, and they were fixed on nuts and bolts and could be easily dismantled and removed and were movable in nature, and therefore the credit was allowed. Delhi High Court in the erstwhile regime had given, in case of Vodafone Services Limited, had allowed sunward credit on telecommunication towers. Now here, since the law specifically exclude telecommunication towers, the credit shouldn't be eligible. Now, whether ITC is available in respect of goods or services procured for construction of special purpose buildings, cold storage, theater, hotel, marriage hall, warehouse, and if warehouse, if with prefabricated building technologies used, telecommunication towers, acrobats, and water wall, then what should be the fate, whether the ITC would be eligible? Since Bollywood fan, I will again like to take first the acrobats and water wall. Now, what these acropods mean? If you have seen this Munna Bhai movie on Marine Line, there are this star-shaped huge structures, around 8-10 feet structures, which are piled on one another, which are kept on one another. These are known as acrobat. Konkal Energy Private Limited, breakwater wall, what is this? Breakwater wall is a wall created beneath the water level, under the water level, so that the impact of the waves is mellowed down and they don't hit the vessel very hard. And so that the vessel can be easily harped or you know, anchored on the jetty and they don't shake. So that is water breakwater wall. Acrobats are typically kept again ahead of the breakwater wall and near the jetty. They are piled up so that the water doesn't hit them and you know, cause damage to jetty. Now, what did Konkan LNG Private Limited held that? The appellant held that these are plant and machinery and therefore should be allowed. The appellate authority of advance ruling had said that we are not even deliberating whether they are plant and machinery or not. Even if they are plant and machinery, breakwater wall, the term itself says that it is a wall, it is a civil structure, and therefore the credit won't be available. For acrobats, for piling of acrobats, lot of civil work and earth work is to be done. And acrobats themselves are of civil structures, though movable if tried to be moved, but they are very heavy. And they are for piling, lot of civil work has to be done. And therefore the credit shouldn't be available. Now, coming to the other structures, cold storage, theater, hotel, marriage hall. For this, we have already seen Varalakshmi Mahal LLP, marriage hall, the credit won't be eligible. Now, there is a ruling of Tewari Warehousing Construction, where they use prefabricated technology to construct the warehouse, and the contention was whether ITC is available or not. What is prefabricated technology? If you have seen the pillars, the walls, the windows, the metal structure, they come ready-made and they are simply assembled at the site. Now for assembling also, you require a foundation on which you fix it. And the application of walls and the civil structure is through cement and concrete. And ultimately it becomes an immovable property. It cannot be dismantled without breakages. And therefore it becomes immovable property, whether through prefabricated building technology or some other technology. Since immovable property, the credit won't be available. And in general, cold storage, theater, hotel, marriage hall, warehouses, these are at the end of the day building, and the credit towards building is not eligible. Telecommunication towers specifically excluded shouldn't be eligible. Now, basically, these questions to summarize into very simple term, there is a factory, factory estate has factory premises, and it has a township, which typically has residential accommodation. You will have shops there, schools, and to maintain this temple. And therefore you will typically have repair, maintenance and upkeep services for your township, your playground, swimming pool, footpath, gardens, temple, and whether the credit should be eligible or not. So this was the contention. Two different AERs on this. National Aluminium Company Limited. The company said that since the expenditure is, you know, in form of fringe benefit to the employees and should be form of perquisite, and there is no tax on the output supply through this, the credit should not be available. This is appellate authority of advance ruling. Another ruling, Ordnance Factory, again, appellant authority of advance ruling. However, the facts are little different in this case. Here, the appellant used to recover amount towards accommodation, marriage hall, recreational hall, school fees. They used to recover. So what the appellate authority of advanced billing said, that these ultimately constitute exam services under the notification. And therefore you are supplying exam services and therefore the input should not be eligible. Now coming to my view, Ordnance Factory, I agree with the view because there was some recovery being done and therefore it will amount to supply and supply to related party because employer-employee is a related party as per the prescribed schedule. But coming to National Aluminium, whether it becomes part of fringe benefit, whether it becomes part of perquisite or not, I think that should not be the matter of contention. In the past, there have been rulings of the High Court in case of cement companies where you require township so that you can attract talent and employees, because generally factories are far away from the city limits and are at remote location. To get the employees, you need to put this infrastructure, and these are very much necessary for the business as a whole. And therefore, in my view, the credit, apart from the construction services towards immovable property and work contract services, rest, if they are not capitalized and if they are in the nature of repair, maintenance and upkeep, they should all be eligible. Again, the same set of rulings. The another set of question was whether garden making and landscaping will be eligible. Both the, under both the cases, the appellate authority held that it should be eligible. And the reason which was provided was they prevent pollution, they are for pollution control, soil erosion, and they are prescribed under the law, under the pollution control laws, and therefore should be eligible. Here I would have a different, I will little bit have a different this thing. It is good they have allowed, but what if they are not mandated as a pollution control or not prescribed under the law? In my view, it still should be eligible because a garden, a landscape, a beautiful landscape, it provides a conducive atmosphere for the employees, the workers, and that is essential for the business. Secondly, if there are visitors, it helps in building brand or image, and therefore it should be available even if not mandatorily prescribed under the law. Again, under the same set of rulings, whether establishing, maintaining and furnishing of guest house or transit hotel, including landscaping on this transit, near this transit and hostel or guest house would be eligible. Ordnance Factory had different set of facts, little bit different from the normative. They used to charge amount or service fee towards the guest house. And therefore it was held that that services are qualifying under the exemption. It's an exam service. Therefore any inputs or input services used in provision of that exam service should not be eligible. Agree with the view, should not be eligible. But National Aluminium, there they had gone with a different footing that even under the guest house, outsiders are staying. And for the employees, it may amount to, again, a perquisite or may not amount to perquisite. But since there is no GST charge on the output supply, there should not be eligible to credit. In my humble view, this is not the right position. Again, in the past law, the high courts, again, in cement companies and in tribunals under other rulings have held that guest houses are again necessary away from the, if you are away from the city limits, it is very much essential and should be eligible. I subscribe to that view and it should be eligible. Whether ITC is available in respect of construction and maintenance of roads in the factory state and whether ITC can be claimed in respect of internal roads of commercial complex. Ordnance Factory, for the roads which were from the factory gate to the factory premises, they said that they are very much related to the business. They are used for transportation of input capital goods and finished goods and should be available. And for the roads which were used in the township, they are not for the business and should not be available. Though they have given a favorable ruling, in my humble opinion, I don't agree with the ruling. The credit shouldn't be available because ultimately roads would qualify as immovable property, construction of immovable property. Secondly, from plant and machinery, if one has to argue, again, it is civil structure. In any case, it is not eligible. It is completely covered under the ambit of 17.5, and therefore, credit on roads should not be eligible. Just as a heads up, under I have put some rulings, there could be others also. Under various courts of the country, the validity of Section 17, 5C and D clause, which we discussed, is put to challenge. And it would be interesting to refer to the ruling of Supreme Court in case of Orissa High Court vis-a-vis these all high courts on the validity of this ruling. Coming to the last leg of this subsection, last clauses, subclause E, F, subclause E, F, G, H, and I. What does they mean? Goods or services or both. Credit is restricted on goods or services on which tax is paid under Section 10, composition levy. I think this they have put out of utmost caution, because as discussed in the initial slides, if you refer the definition of input tax credit, their tax under composition levy is not considered as input tax credit. Once it is not considered as input tax credit, I cannot as such take the credit. That is first point. Second point, under composition levy, the GST is not charged on the face of the invoice. It has to be paid directly by the supplier. So once it's not there on the face of the invoice, I would not be able to take it. And at utmost caution, they have put over here. Goods or services received by a non-resident taxable person except on goods imported by him. Goods or services used for personal consumption. Goods lost, stolen, destroyed, written off, or disposed of by way of gift or free sample. Any tax paid in terms of the following: tax not paid or short paid or erroneously refunded, or input tax credit wrongly availed or utilized by reason of fraud or any willful misstatement, basically tax paid under Section 74. So if my supplier has paid tax under 74 and he is recovering to me, and at the time of recovering the tax, if he gives me a debit note, I as a recipient won't be able to take the credit. Detention or seizure and release of goods and conveyance in transit, Section 129. So basically, if my conveyance or goods are detained, and pursuant to that, if the supplier has paid the tax, then the credit is not eligible. Confiscation of goods or conveyance and levy of penalty. Again, due to confiscation, if any tax is being paid, then also I will not be eligible to take the credit. Some relevant circulars and FAQ. Circular 92/11/2019, it says that no ITC on in respect of input services and capital goods distributed as grips or free samples. In case of scheme of buy one get one free, it is said that it is a case of supply of two or more individual supplies for a single price. It is not a case of an individual supply of free goods. It should be ticked either as composite or mixed supply. ITC is not disallowable. Basically, they are saying ITC is allowable. Sectorial FAQ, no ITC is required in respect of parts replaced under warranty, since value of warranty services includes the charges to be incurred for parts replacement during the warranty period. So basically, just to give you a perspective, you buy an appliance, and it is under warranty, and say after a year, some part has to be replaced, the dealer or the manufacturer would replace it free of cost since it is warranty. So the contention earlier was, or the apprehension earlier was, since I am not charging anything on the part or the spare which I have given under warranty, the ITC of that part or spare will be eligible or not. So the FAQ said that actually it is eligible, and rightly so, because while selling the goods, I would have already anticipated that certain parts may go into the warranty, and I would have considered in the final price and discharged GST at the time of sale, and therefore it should not be eligible. Now, certain questions. So Section 17.5G provides that ITC will not be available where goods or services are used for personal consumption. What does the term personal consumption mean? Whether there can be any personal expenses in case of an incorporated entity, that is artificial juristic person. Before, you know, coming to the conclusions, one year, Chennai Port Trust. Now it had incurred expenses for medical equipment, apparatus and consumables used in in-house hospital and their repairing, and for a personal consumption of employees and pensioners. So it was held that these medical facilities, whatever is being used, it's for personal consumption of the employees and the ex-employees, pensioners, and therefore the ITC was restricted. Now coming to the basic question, what would personal consumption mean? In my view, there cannot be any personal consumption in case of an incorporated entities, that is artificial juristic person. Reason being, personal consumption can only be there something into a business like a sole proprietorship. And just to give you an example, a sole proprietorship who is into a confectionery business or who is manufacturing biscuits, he orders, inputs some flour, atta, and that flour, some portion he takes to his home for his consumption and his family's consumption. That is something which can be treated as personal consumption. Otherwise, what I feel, till what extent, till what stretch you will take this personal consumption. Today in office, you have been provided with a table, with chair, with laptop, and internet, and air conditioner. Will you say it's personal consumption? And forget in office, today in times of work from home, I have my couple of clients who have laptops who were given earlier also. So that was nothing new, but they have even given office chairs to their employees to use at home, even printers and internet, the hotspot connection, the dongle, that is also being given. So this is not personal consumption. This is something which is being provided for the effective execution of the duties of the employees. So we will have to carve out that distinction, and with keeping in mind, we will now go the practical issues. Now, in this case, if a company takes on rent a guest house or a hotel accommodation for director or the employee, whether it will be deemed as personal consumption. Here, there is ruling of POSCO India, Advance Ruling Authority. Now, what the facts were, there was a general manager and an MD, which has come from the overseas holding company and were now on the payrolls of the subsidiary for the working and management of the subsidiary. And they were put under a hotel accommodation during their work tenure. And the appellant approached the advance ruling authority whether the credit of the GST charged by the hotel will be available as credit or not. Again, I'm not on the conclusion. I don't agree with the conclusion, but more on that, I don't agree with the approach the authority has taken to come to its conclusion. The authority said that whether the employees were placed under a hotel or at some other place, it would not have changed the purpose or their service to the business. They would have performed in the same function. That is their first thing. Second, what they are trying to say is, if the company would have taken a residential accommodation somewhere else, like in a society, they would have taken a flat, no GST would have been charged, because on residential accommodation, there is an exemption and the concern of credit would not be allowed. Third, they said that it is a personal consumption and not be allowed. Now here, two things to ponder upon. Does the authority or the department has the authority to question my proprietary or to question my business decision, whether I want to place them under a hotel or somewhere else? That is first point. Secondly, I'm doing it for my business. As I mentioned, the employees are staying the same analogy of the guest house and the earlier rulings. The credit should be eligible. They cannot question my proprietary and they cannot come to a conclusion if they would have kept in flat, there would have been GST. Here there is GST. Ultimately, it is eligible. There is nothing like personal consumption. This I am providing them the facilities for better performance of their duty, which are used in my business. This is interesting. If a company distributes goods or services free of cost to its customers or dealers as part of sales promotion, whether ITC on procurement or production of such goods can be claimed, whether ITC in respect of goods or services to dealers or distributor pursuant to sales promotion scheme is blocked under Section 17(5)(h). I will take the ruling of appellate authority in case of Sanofi India, and the rest two rulings I shall jointly take it up. Now, Sanofi India is a pharma company, and to have you a recall value or better recumbrance, So it manufactures CombiFlame. The popular brand is CombiFlame. Now the company had introduced a scheme which they termed as Shubh Labh loyalty program. And what typically it was, if a distributor purchases for the goods of a certain amount, say 10,000 rupees, he gets certain notional points, say 100 points, so on and so forth. Now this points, he can redeem against certain specified goods. Like for 400 points, he will get a watch. For 800 points, he will get a mobile. The dispute was whether the ITC of this watch or mobile, which is distributed pursuant to this sales promotion scheme, free of cost, will be treated as gift and credit should be available or not. That was the question. And second question which they put was, they used to give keychains, pens, notepads to distributors and doctors with the name Sanofi endorsed on it, and whether the credit is eligible or not, because they said that it's a brand recall product, it's for sales promotion and marketing. So advance ruling authority rejected the ITC. They didn't allow it. They said that they are in the nature of gift and therefore it should not be eligible. The matter went to appellate authority of advance ruling. And again, the way, again, a good ruling to read it, what the advance ruling authority held, that they referred to the ruling of Sonia Bhatia, a Supreme Court ruling, where they held that gift has been held to be a voluntary transfer of property by one to another without any consideration or compensation thereof. A gift is a gratuity and an act of generosity and does not require a consideration. If there is a consideration for the transaction, it is not a gift. In the same case, it was also held that gift is a transfer which does not contain any element of consideration in any shape and form. Love, affection, spiritual benefit, and many other factors may enter in the intention of the donor to make a gift. But this filial consideration cannot be called or held to be legal consideration as understood by law. So this is, they referred to, the appellant referred to this ruling. The appellate authority appreciated the ruling. Further, this appellate authority held that it need not be necessary that there should be a written contractual agreement, because this was one of the points by advance ruling authority. It need not be a written contractual agreement. Agreement can be oral or written. And therefore, they said that this is subject to conditions and it is not absolute. And it creates a contractual obligation on Sanofi to provide this incentives or this items. And therefore, the credit was eligible. For the second set of goods, which is keychain, pens, and letter pad, it had that it is for brand promotion, branding, brand recall, and marketing and promotion purposes and should be eligible. Now, the other two rulings, which are negative and by advance ruling authority, they are Biostate India Limited, where it gives gold coin on some parameters where the dealer and distributor achieved it. Surfa Coats, where they give TV, certain products, foreign trips. And this was the whole contention. Just they didn't allow it, but couple of points where I said I don't agree with the way they have gone with the ruling. They said that in this case, the scheme was announced through pamphlet. Now the scheme could be announced through pamphlet or circular. There was no written contractual agreement. And therefore, in absence of agreement, it should be treated as gift. Further on the supply of gift, there is no GST and shouldn't be allowed. Now, everything on which I supply did not have a GST. And this is this, you cannot determine my input. That is my first contention. Second, they forget the very basic essence that contracts could be, or agreements could be oral or written. This is given under the Indian Contract Act, that an agreement, and this is again established if one refers to the ruling of Carlyle versus Carbolic Smoke Ball Company from the English law. If you recall, this was this we have read under our foundation days, where the facts of the case was where Carbolic Smoke Ball Company used to make a medicine, and they advertised that if anyone who takes this medicine and after taking this medicine, if they contracted flu, then the company will give X amount of reward. Now, Mrs. Carlyle, she took this smoke ball and she contracted flu. She claimed the reward to the company. The company said that the reward cannot be given to you because you never said that you are, you know, accepting our challenge or offer. And under the law, it was clearly held that once a valid offer is given, and if that offer is accepted by me, I fulfill the condition, it becomes a binding contract. And this needs to be appreciated, and basis that the contracts or agreement can be oral or written, and something which is conditional and subject to fulfillment of conditions cannot be gift. Gifts are unconditional, and therefore the credit should be available. Next AR is of Golden Tobacco Limited, where on say 100 units of cigarette packets, if you purchase, the company used to give 10 packets extra without any additional consideration, whether credit is eligible or not. The authority referred to the 2019 circular, which we have seen, where it says that it is ultimately a marketing gimmick. The 100 packets would actually subsume the price of 10 also, and therefore should be eligible. A right decision, I would say. Whether ITC in respect of customary gifts given on the occasion of Diwali will be eligible. So basically on festive or some occasions or as such, on say completion of financial year, if I give certain gifts to employees and my customers, will it be eligible or not? So there is a ruling of Musashi Auto Parts Private Limited, where it has said that ITC on gifts and presents to employees and customers are not eligible to be availed by the company because they are in the nature of gifts. And we also agree with the view. So it shouldn't be eligible. If a company procures goods or services to discharge its CSR obligation, whether ITC will be available on procurement of such goods or services, whether ITC will be available on construction of school as CSR activity. So there are two questions. Before coming to the answer, two AERs and one earlier law ruling. Dwarikes Sugar Industries Limited by UP Authority of Advance Ruling. It says that CSR activities are mandated under the law, under the Companies Act, and therefore the ITC shall be eligible. Polycab Wires didn't allow the ITC. It's a negative ruling. Now under earlier regime, during the Senvet regime, there is this ruling of SL Propack Limited of Mumbai CSTAT, where it has held that the credit shall be available towards CSR. Now, if the credit was available by a tribunal in the earlier law, then the current law has widened the scope of input services, the eligibility to credit, and it should be available. Now, it throws a couple of questions. Now, CSR mandates me, Companies Act mandates me 2% of profit to be treated as CSR I have to apply towards CSR activity. What if I use more than 2%, then only up till 2%, whatever input services are used, the credit will be eligible and rest will be denied. In my view, it shouldn't be looked in that fashion. The thing is, a CSR activity is mandated and therefore undertaken. And at times, a particular activity or campaign may require a higher money. Secondly, a CSR, which is a job of philanthropy, ultimately gets you an image, a brand building. Just to give you a perspective, today Tata, we recall the brand for their philanthropy activities, for their charity. So it gives you a promotion in brand, and therefore it should be eligible. Now, second, whether ITC will be available on construction of school under CSR activity, 17.5 construction of immovable property not available, then what should you do? CSR mandated, construction not available. Here my humble view is, if you are capitalizing in your books of accounts, it won't be eligible. There is a specific exclusion and that will be it. One more thing to be kept in mind, under section 17.5 clause H, goods lost, stolen, destroyed, or given as gift or otherwise disposed of as free sample or written off. Now it is only towards gifts. And therefore, for your CSR activity, or you, if you gift services, the restriction doesn't apply. And yes, the services can be gifted. There can be prepaid vouchers for your air travel and all this. These vouchers can be gifted and there is no restriction. It's only on goods. And therefore, that can be explored. Whether restriction of ITC under 17.5H applies where goods lost, stolen, destroyed, written off pertains to outward supply, or does it apply where the goods lost, stolen, destroyed, written off pertains to inward supply? So basically what we are trying to say over here is, when we say goods, when we refer this section, and the start of the section, section 17.5 says, input tax credit on in relation to input and input services shall not be available, namely. So input and input services in relation to, the word is in relation to, and therefore how it has to be read. So what we are trying to say, if today I have got some input and I have manufactured, processed and created a finished goods, and my finished goods is lost, then am I required to reverse the credit or ITC of the inputs? In my view, a position can be taken that the term in respect of, which was analyzed by Supreme Court in case of Sustit Tobacco Company, which was from Central Excise perspective, where again the words were in respect of. They said that the word in respect of has to be read as on. So it should be on goods and not in relation to. Something indirect is not covered, only the direct nexus is covered. Applying that logic, it could be only on inputs. But this view is litigious and will have to be litigated. Now, whether ITC will be available or section 17.5 will apply in following cases: natural loss of goods within while manufacturing process. So it's a natural loss in manufacturing process, ITC should be available. So it is loss, but then normal loss should be eligible. Abnormal loss while manufacturing process still should be available. Should I am using it for or in relation to my business, it is for my manufacturing process. Abnormal loss of goods due to natural calamity, in my view, should not be available because here the goods have destroyed and should not be available. Bearing the earlier discussion of inputs versus finished goods, that still could be applied over here. Loss of goods while in testing process, yes, it is for my manufacturing activity. I would like to test my batch or lot and then only send the finished products in the market, and therefore should be eligible. Goods which have become complete, absolute or expired. Expired goods will typically be fully written off, expired accounting treatment, and fully written off goods, the ITC won't be eligible. Whether the ITC attributable to goods lost in transit will be available. Here again, ruling of the erstwhile regime, Hindustan Zinc Limited, credit cannot be denied on transit loss of inputs occurring on account of dry of moisture content and human error in weighment. Further, an advance ruling in case of Jay Chemical Industries, Gujarat Authority of Advance Ruling, where due to fire the intermediate and semi-finished and finished goods had destroyed, the credit was required to be reserved. Now, certain questions. Section 17.5H restricts ITC where goods are destroyed. What does the term destroyed mean? Whether it refer to complete destruction or a damaged goods will also be covered under subsection. So here I would say that destruction one should imply as complete destruction only. Damage is not covered under 17.5H. They have used the word destroyed. And destroyed would typically mean a complete loss which cannot be recovered. Damaged goods may still be used with lesser utility. It may still be sold in the market with lesser intrinsic value. It reduces the value or the utility of the damaged goods. And therefore, the credit towards damaged goods should be eligible because ultimately, when I supply it further, I'm going to discharge GST though at a lower value. Now, the another question is, Section 17.5H restricts ITC where goods are written off. What does the term write-off mean? Whether write-off should be full or partial, write-off or is covered by the subsection? What if goods are not actually written off, rather provision is made for reduction in value? Again, since the word are simply used at write-off, I would say that it should be a complete write-off. Partial write-off, again, as I mentioned, it will have an intrinsic value. When I supply, I would discharge GST maybe at a lesser value. And therefore, when we say write-off, it should be complete. When we make a provision, if partial, then again, not eligible. If complete, then eligible. Sorry, vice versa. Whether tax paid during investigation would be hit by 17.5(1) even if SCN issued later. So as I mentioned, under Section 74, where any tax is not paid due to any willful misstatement, suppression of facts, and if subsequently paid. But then what will be the event which we define? which will determine. So I think it is only after SCN allegation is being put that short tax has not been paid under section 74, and after due process it is then culminated into finality, the allegation. And therefore, if a tax paid before SCN, in my view, the credit will be eligible to the customer. What about in respect of where tax paid in respect of goods detained by any technical or procedural error in case of e-way bill? So whether it will be hit by 17.5i, and that is the question. So here I would like to say yes, here we can take a conservative view, since it blanketly says that any tax paid under 129 should not be available, and therefore it doesn't put any leeway to interpretation, and the credit should not be eligible. And last question, expenses related to company offsite. Now, company offsite, if what should be done? According to me, it's a bundle of activity. The offsite has two, three activity. At the offsite, there is some element of training, there is some element of team building, and there is a element of refreshment, enjoyment, I would say a regeneration. Regeneration, refreshment could be disputed whether related to business or not, but I still feel it is related to business when I look at this bundle of activity, the training, the team building activity, association of the employees to the aligning them to the goals of the management, and ultimately regeneration. This ultimately helps my employee to perform better, and it is related to business. And therefore, in my humble view, since the expenses are common and cannot be segregated only for the enjoyment or the regeneration part, it's a host or bundle of activities. And in absence of any mechanism to, you know, identify two different intrinsic activities, the credit should be eligible. Whether services like car insurance, repair and maintenance of car, etc., avail for motor vehicle eligible for ITC? We have seen in the past, yes, if I'm eligible to take the credit of motor vehicle, then towards this expenses also I will take the credit. And further, if I'm further selling, I'm into the business of buying and selling of motor vehicle, or I'm into insurance business, I can take the credit. Now, certain questions which are relating to 17.5b, pickup and drop facility for employees. If it is a bus, then whatever, whether I purchase or a hire or lease, if the sitting capacity is above 13, 14 or above basically, then I'm eligible. If below that, one need to test it before judiciary with the argument, can I treat it as it's a transportation of passengers? And irrespective whether it is bus or car, if it is mandated by law, then I'm eligible. Food provided to employees, it's not available under the specific exclusion clause unless mandated by the law. Medical or health kit for employees. Now, if you refer, the exclusion says health services. What I'm referring to, medical or health kit. So basically, these are goods and not services, like your bandage and your medicines and antiseptics and ointments. And therefore, since it is not excluded, it should be eligible. Group insurance for employees. So health and life are covered under the exclusion, therefore not eligible. Accidental, yes. Free crash services for employees. What is crash? Crash is basically a facility where you can leave your kids and they will be taken care of. So that is known as crash. And for, in my view, crash facilities should be available for credit because of two reasons. If you refer the IT industry typically and the KPO and BPO, if you want to attract good talent and typically a female talent, then you need to have this facility. And these IT industry and KPO or BPO are highly competitive industry. They employ masses of people, and therefore there is a high competition to get good people. And therefore, I think with that argument, the credit should be eligible. This is all from my side. And I typically say all great changes are preceded by chaos. Chaos because too many ARs, too many circulars and notifications. This is something, a word of caution. This is only for education purposes. You will have to apply your caution while advising a client. And we are ready for question and answer. I think a couple of minutes are left.
I request the members if they have any question, they can put in the chat box or can ask directly to the speaker.
I think there are no questions coming in. Thank you from my side. Hope you enjoyed the session as much as I did, and it provided an opportunity of learning to you. Again, I put a vote of thanks to the committee and the Surat branch of WRC of ICF. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, sir. On behalf of Surat branch of ICI, I would like to thank you for such an eminent session. It was worth hearing to you. We would look forward to you having again in Surat branch, sir.
Surely, my pleasure.
Thank you, sir.
Thanks.